Hello and welcome to the Inspiration and Enlightenment Slow Talk. In this little series, I read chapters from Gawain and the Green Knight, which is a novelet I wrote, and explain its Enlightenment symbolism. What man doesn't want to hold his son? Ragnell has the same purgatory fire in her eyes as his mother did when Gawain stole an apple. This is unjustified. He didn't steal anything. He holds up another gold coin. She spits on the coin and his hand. Carry him, she pushes the newborn in his arms. I need to fetch firewood. What if it relieves itself? She slams the door on the way out. The empty notion of child has taken the form of a tiny face sticking out of a linen wrap that looks like a poor man's birthday present. Gawain pokes it. Two wide eyeballless eyes stare at him, and then the face scrunches up and it cries. I knew it. He shakes the child. It blares as if its life were in danger. Please don't cry. He regrets to have come here, but he had to put an end to Ragnell's letters before his uncle learned of the affair, or, God forbid, the queen. He paces the earth-floored shack, showing the child the cupboard, bed, and stove, but the tiny storm can't be calmed. Whistling doesn't help either, neither clinking spoons at pots, nor swaying a candle. He remembers his mother's lullaby. Lulay, lulo, lulay, luli, beway, buey, balmy bairn. Sweet sleep now. I saw a sweet and seemly sight, a blissful bird, a blossom bright, that morning made so very right. Lulay, lulo, lulay, luli, beway, buey, balmy bairn. Sweet sleep now. The tiny one then drools, yawns, and dozes off, pacifying Gawain with an angel face. The child feels somewhat valuable now, not for what it is, but for what it could become. A boy first, then a man. Gawain fathers a smile. He could teach him honor. Teach honor. The realization hits him like a battering ram. Teaching honor is more glorious than killing sinners. His son is a treasure chest he can fill with gems of virtue. And although his son is as light as a rolled up white flag, he feels the weight of duty in his arms, as the ancient father-son covenant renews itself between the two. For the first time since his mother died, love rises in his heart, in the form of a dazzling angel. Fully risen, it challenges the shining knight, who decided on an honorable death. Their swords cross and Gawain breaks apart. The door opens and a gust blows dry autumn leaves into the hut. Ragnell enters, kicks the door shut, and drops an armful of dry branches beside the hearth. The fire in her eyes dies when she beholds her son sleeping in his arms. She crosses to them and caresses her child's cheek. My sweet little one. The child's lips move, sucking a dream breast. You're not useless after all, fine sir. She returns to the fireplace and throws a branch on the dying ember. Are you aware of my ordeal? Gawain asks. The entire realm is. It's the most imbecile thing I ever heard of. Can think of. But it's madness. Honor it is. Whatever. I need to return to Camelot. She reclaims the child and rocks it gently. Give him a name. Why me? You're the father. He scratches his head. I can't think of one now. I shall when I return. She gives him an as if stare and takes her son to the fireplace. He puts on his coat and places the gold coin on the table with a click. She turns and glares at it as if it were the devil's fingernail, but lodges no protest. He stops at the door. What day is it? It's All Saint Day tomorrow. Already? Damnatis. Why? Farewell, Ragnell. Farewell, Dad. She makes sure Dad sounds like dead. Do you know what is a kingdom? King Arthur taps his shoulders with Excalibur as if he's dubbing himself. A land with a king on it? Gawain peeks at Queen Guinevere, who is surrounded by an unusually large flock of stitching, whispering, and side-glancing castle ladies. A land with a large flock and a king who's shepherd. King Arthur straightens his crown with the tip of his sword. And sheepdogs. He points at Gawain. Dogs are magnificent creatures. Human wolves. Nature bent to God's will. Honorable creatures. Gawain crosses his arms. Honor, honor, honor. Don't be so greedy. You already have more honor than any other dog knight. Be the keeper of my flock's honor. His voice trails off. The shepherds. Uncle, I have an opportunity for glory. People may tell my story for 1,000 years. Glory is reserved for kings. Arthur points with his sword at the window. I decided to make you a little shepherd and give you land. Shepherding is not my call. Queen Guinevere breaks off the stitching. You always keep to yourself. That's so unnatural. Are you sure the call you hear is the call of honor and not the call of the wild? I'm sure. An honor charm I have. Gawain holds up the Virgin Mary pendant. The queen rises and places her hand on her husband's shoulder. We heard you have a son. Gawain meets the king's eyes. Did you have me followed? His uncle gives him a king keeps the knight's close grin. A whirl of bile rises from Gawain's stomach. You! Why don't you marry her? Queen Guinevere asks. You're the last carrying your family name. I don't love her. The ladies comment on the fact with sighs of relief. Every day I overhear your dear name in lady talks. The queen gestures with her eyes at the damsels. Name the one who shines brightest and we shall join you in matrimony. She shall bring up this child and bear you more. I fear the woman I desire does not exist, my lady. A chorus of his disapprovals rises on the dais. Excusez-moi? Gawain bows deep. I meant no disrespect. I just haven't met the woman who... He shrugs. I don't know. Tell me, what is your ideal of a woman? Our lady's eyes are on him now. Curious, hopeful, some confident, some already resentful. I wish for... He wallows the secret desire in his mouth like a hot potato. A friend? That's what comrades are for. King Arthur scratches his head and tilts his crown. Shh! Queen Guinevere waves him off. What do you mean by friend? How can I say this? A wife in arms? A heroine? Heroine? Queen Arthur snaps his fingers and points at Gawain. You're infatuated with the Green Knight. I remember how you stared at her. See? The call of the wild. Gawain cringes as if caught butt naked in the castle hallway. Did you hear that? The dais is now a storm. Scandalous! Gracious God, Queen Guinevere is as pale as a pearl. Please tell me this isn't true. Of course it's not true, my queen. Gawain gives his uncle a one more word and I spill your infatuation beans there. I'm only concerned about my honor. If you are so determined to keep that absurd rendezvous with that murderous woman, at least try to survive. Now the king waves off the queen. That giantess kills him with a leaf if she wants to. He shall stay. My honor demands me to go. Please accept my apologies. This is the third time Gawain expresses regret, despite not feeling wrongful at all. But I agree, I should find a way to survive. It's just, how can I vanish an enemy I know nothing about? About that, Arthur pokes the arm of his throne. The Green Knight is not from this world. I know that. So, talk to the bishop. He should know how to deal with otherworlders. Good idea. What day is it? St. Peter's and Paul's. Why? Nothing. Thank you, uncle. Queen, ladies, Gawain bows and flees the royal pressure and the ladies' bothersome expectations. A kingdom is a fatherland, King Arthur shouts after him. Father, get it? She's a demon. The bishop spreads his arms. The sacristan helps him into his golden cope. Are you sure, Your Excellency? Gawain asks. I felt a jolt when I severed her head. Demons are very mischievous, the bishop wags his bejeweled finger. No need to oblige. The altar boys nod in unison. But a covenant was struck, Your Grace. She tricked you with witchcraft. Obviously. The bishop plucks a loose thread on his cope. Two pearls drop and prance across the floor. Gawain steps on one. What do you suggest, Father? The other pearl escapes under the credence. The altar boys nudge the youngest, who drops to his knees and fishes for it. Break the covenant and make a confession. Gawain shudders as if hell just swallowed the holy sea. Are you asking me to commit a sin intentionally? Play hard, pray harder, the bishop punts the kneeling altar boy. Make haste, he slaps the head of the sacristan. What are you waiting for? Get the tailor. This is wrong, Gawain's foot twitches, itching to kick the bishop's brocaded behind. What do you want, knight? That I exorcise the green witch? Don't go to the appointment. Who takes the axe shall perish by the axe. Jesus went to his appointment with the cross, and so shall I. Gawain slams the sacristy's door on his way out. Torn between chivalry and fatherland and fatherhood, Gawain searches Camelot's libraries for particulars about his beloved nemesis, but no scripture mentions her. Bloody, beautiful warrioress. He consults the nuns and monks, but none has heard of her, nor the grassy chapel. He hates Merlin, but now he wishes that he still lived in Camelot. He would know that wicked Nimue bewitched him. Cursed be she. Wait, what about the witches? Gawain hunts down a few sorceresses in the woods and presses them for advice, but they haven't heard of the Green Knight either. His last resort is a drizzled druid, a Celtic relic, who serves the giant king Ritagaur on Mount Snowdon. It hurts to consult the heathen of heathens, worse, it is in vain. The hermit has not heard of her, nor has he met a green warrior on his journeys to the other world. Back in Camelot, Gawain shaves his head and announces the day of his departure, the first advent. All he has left is prayers and hope, hope for a divine revelation or intervention. But the Mother of God still doesn't want to get involved. Only time does, the grim thief, whose fist never opens. Dragon's lair filled with gold can't buy the shortest moment. One by one, the November days desert Gawain's life like rats a sinking ship. I added this chapter to escalate Gawain's crisis, an honorable death or to be a father. Gawain's story is actually a string of dilemmas and crises, which is true to life. Every day we need to decide between what is right and what is needful or useful. For example, shall we lie to get an advantage in business and make money, or shall we tell the truth, which is the right thing to do? And worse, of course, if we need to decide between two right things or two honorable things. And that takes us far beyond morality and into the no man's land of the gray zone of wrong and right. And if that happens to us, we need to strike a balance. And balance is art. And this particular art is the art of karma. And then we have another crisis, the crisis between his honorable death and the duty for his fatherland. So Gawain makes a balanced decision to go to the appointment with the Green Knight, but to try to find a way to survive. Yeah, and mind, Gawain is again exposed to temptations, first by King Arthur, who offers him land, and second by Queen Guinevere. And remember that karma comes to us in two forms. The first form is through an accident or loss, and the second one is through temptation. In both cases, we get into challenging situation, and then we have to acquire knowledge and skill to get out of this situation. Thank you for watching this episode of the Inspiration and Enlightenment Slow Talk. Please help spreading the light with a like and a share, and don't forget to subscribe. Love and light. Thank you.